Hello, Guardians. Welcome back to Tower Casuals, the Destiny podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Corey Deergan. Alongside me, as always, is the time-gated old weapon himself, Josh Lee.
Let me tell you something. I was so hyped coming out of that tree on Tuesday, and then I was it dipped a little. It's not gone. It's definitely not gone. It didn't dampen it too much. It's just kind of like a, wish you hadn't done this type of thing. So, just kind of minor inconveniences, I guess you could say. But we're going to get it all. We have a lot to talk about.
Yeah, we have a lot. Gosh, I have been busy trying to catch up with the last time.
So, Corey, fill us in for people who do not know what happened. Fill us in on what you were doing this past
week. Yeah, so I went to PAX East, which is a gaming convention. It used to be called the Penny Arcade Expo, which is why it's called PAX East. Long story short, Penny Arcade sold it was the 20th anniversary of PAX, so that was fun. And I was pretty much just shaking hands and kissing babies and, I don't know, dying a little bit because it was so busy. But I met a lot of cool people, did a lot of cool things, recorded some podcasts, did some interviews. It was fun. It was really cool. So that's what I was doing, Josh. Met Major Nelson. Xbox Live's Major Nelson.
Yeah. Formerly Xbox Live's Major Nelson.
Yes, now Midwest Games Major Nelson. Which was
consultant
my...
gamer.
Yeah.
Major Nelson.
Yes. It was cool, man. Like, so the Midwest Games booth was by far my favorite booth there.
And we're gonna not get just because of Larry Herb.
No, he wasn't even there the first day I was there. I didn't even know he was going to be there. Because he was at GDC, I think.
Yeah, he kind of showed up like last minute. Like, I thought, it's funny. I had the thought, I was like, I saw that him say that he was at PAX, and I was like, oh, damn, I wonder if Corey's seen him. And then immediately underneath that, I saw your picture of him.
Yeah.
So, or with him, I guess I should say.
Yeah, it was cool, man. Like, that day he was there, like, I wasn't even, like, looking for him. Like, I went over there to, like, check out the third game from that booth because I had an appointment. And he was there in the booth, and the lady that had been like running my appointments the previous few days was like, would you like to meet him? And I was like, well, I'm not gonna say no, you know. I'm like look, I know he has a meet and greet in like an hour, I don't want to pull him away from whatever he's doing. And she's like, no, it's not a big deal. And she just went over and got him, and he came over and talked to us for like 15 minutes.
Dude, that's awesome. I love Larry. He's such a big reason, like, why socials are the way, and, like, community teams are the way they are in gaming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, he was, like, the first, like, real personality, I feel, that we had working at one of these companies.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. And he couldn't have been nicer.
Yeah.
He couldn't have been more helpful and just, you know, telling us a bunch of stuff. It was... I don't know, man. Everybody I met there was like, couldn't have been nicer. I met the former Giant Beast Cast team, which was awesome, which was like, I mean, you know, me and Giant Bomb, that's like the reason why a podcast is because of Giant Bomb. And I met all them. That was fun.
You met Ben Starr at Starbucks?
Yeah. We ran into Ben Starr at Starbucks. It was awesome.
He looks very alarmed in that picture. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, so that story, Josh, real quick.
Oh boy.
Let's unpack this. Let's unpack this story.
I'm not gonna lie, I saw that and I was like, everybody looks very happy. Ben just looks like he is like waiting for his caffeine and is slightly taken aback by the video game people.
Let's unpack this. So I'm like, we're at Starbucks, okay, we all ordered. And I'm just standing there on my phone trying to be out of the way because I'm the largest person in the room, because I'm a large person.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, this guy walks in front of me, and I'm sure you know this. Everybody that walks by, I got to look up and look at them to make sure they're not some shady person for some reason.
Yeah.
And I do a double take, and I'm like, I think that's Ben Starr. And I'm like, well, okay. Because, like, it's cool, but, like, I don't want to bother people, you know? I'm like, Ben Starr, that's super cool. And then I'm like, I look over my shoulder, and, like, Stephanie and Pat are like freaking out because they're huge Final Fantasy fans and Ben Star fans, and like they were like, should we go say hi to him? I'm like, look, he's here for the convention. You know he's here for the convention.
Yeah.
At least wait till he orders his coffee and then say hi to him.
Yeah.
But he was really cool. He stood with us for like 10 minutes and
talked. No. I've never seen this dude like be rude to anybody. He has been like super graceful about everything, like in person and his online interactions. Mm-hmm. His videos where he talks in the Clive voice are just so great.
Yeah. It was cool because like when we were getting ready to leave, we asked him for a picture, right?
Right.
So we were moving out of the Starbucks because it's a tiny place to go out into the lobby of the hotel. And these two cosplayers are walking into Starbucks and they're Final Fantasy 16 characters.
Yeah.
And one of them is Jill.
Oh boy.
And she like stops dead in her tracks, and he like, she didn't even say anything, and he just walked up to her. He's like, hold on a second, to us. And he's like, hi, I'm Ben Starr. Nice to meet you. And like gave her a huge hug. It was like the most adorable thing I've ever seen.
He feels like one of the most genuine people in the industry.
Oh yeah. He was awesome. He was
like, you cannot be happier when you see somebody like that attain that level of like overnight fame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And like just to be like so gracious about it too.
Yeah. So that
I'm very happy. I think most people are in agreement that if Baldur's Gate 3 hadn't been Baldur's Gate 3, he probably would have won all the best performance awards last year.
Yeah.
Like him and Cameron Monaghan would have cleaned up.
Yeah.
But great for Ben Starr. Mm-hmm. I'm so happy that he got to be there and be a part of that.
Yeah, it was cool. He was there for the
Warframe. He was there for the Final Fantasy panel.
No, he was there for Warframe.
He's
playing the villain in the new Warframe expansion.
What?
Yeah,
that's funny because like I didn't even realize that. I just, when I saw the pictures, I was like, oh, he's there with Yoshi P. He's there for the Final Fantasy 16 DLC talk.
Yeah, no, that Final Fantasy 16 wasn't there. It was all 14 Dawn.
That's funny because I definitely thought the news came out of there when they released it during PAX.
Yeah.
They released the news about it. I assumed they were talking about it there. What?
Nope. No, it was
that's fucking wild.
The whole Square Enix booth was Final Fantasy 14.
I will say, I mean, 14 does have a massive expansion coming out. It released on Xbox last Wednesday.
Yeah.
And I loved hearing the comments from the director of the expansion. He was like, yeah, it's coming out in June. We wanted to put it out in mid-June, but he's like, I really want to play Shadow of the Erdtree first.
Mm-hmm.
So he's like, everybody who, all the Final Fantasy 14 fans have 1 week to beat Elden Ring DLC.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was like the quote that like took the convention by storm, it felt.
Yeah.
Like even he's acknowledging, like, the director of the most popular MMO on the face of the earth is like,
We really want to play Elden Ring.
Yeah. Who else? Oh, I met Suda51 was there.
Yeah, our friend Grayson Morales interviewed him for Game Rant.
Yeah, it was cool. It was that was cool. I met Scott Apogee. Apogee Entertainment is like a really, really storied, legendary developer. For those who don't know, like Atari era developers. And,
well, and you went to you. I don't know if you actually ended up going, but you had an invite to go to the Atari party, right?
Yeah, we also got an invite to the Twitch party for some
reason.
Okay, I'm, you know, huge Twitch streamer here.
Right? Oh yeah, Twitch streamer Corey.
Yeah, hardcore Twitch streamer. You know, schedule TBD, guys. I'm changing it up. But yeah, we got invited to that. We got, we went to some things, but not, I mean, we're all fucking old. We don't have time for this shit. I was tired at like 8:30, but it was cool. Our friend Cam Hawkins was there. So that was cool.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, man, it was a good time. It was, we might talk a little bit more on Xbox casuals about it, but it was a good time. It was, Oh, I met the Iron Lords too, which was really cool. I went to go see that Simon Quest Castlevania ripoff game. I don't know if you know about that game, Josh.
No, I don't know anything about it.
Oh, it's called... So it's based off of Castlevania Simon's Quest. And it's called The Transylvania Adventures of Simon Quest. And all it is Castlevania 2, but reskinned. It's hilarious. But I was going to go check that out, and I round the corner, and like the Iron Lords are there doing their like pre-event meeting. And I'm like, oh man, this was like a really weird thing to walk into. But they were all, God, they were all super nice too, man. Like they just like talked to me for like 15 minutes and like I was, I don't know, part of their team, I guess. But
yeah, we love Iron Lords.
Yeah. So yeah, it was really cool, man. It was really nice to see some of these like bigger streamers and YouTubers and you know, DJ Storm was there, and they're like a big Nintendo YouTuber, and they have a big podcast. You know, it was cool, man.
There were a lot of people there. Square was also doing some previews for Visions of Mana.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was behind closed doors.
Yeah. I figured when the people that I saw covering it were like Danny Pena, I figured that, yeah.
Yeah, they were inside the Dawn Trail bar booth.
Mm-hmm.
So I tried to get in, but I was not cool enough to get in. But it was fun. It was really, really fun. Also, Nintendo decided to have a booth at the last minute, and everybody was really excited. And this was the story I wanted to tell you, Josh. So it was pretty open there with the developers that PlayStation 5 Pro and Switch 2 exist. Like, right. Very open.
Right.
Like, I had 5 Switch 2 games confirmed to me and 2 PlayStation 5 Pro games confirmed to me while I was there. Also, at the airport on the way home, I sat next to Jeff Grubb, which was fun. Yeah, man, it was wild. We talked about Nintendo's booth was supposed to be full of Switch 2 launch games at PAX.
Yeah, this Nintendo like kind of took everybody by surprise by being like, we're not going to put out the Switch 2 until Q1 2025.
Mm-hmm.
And basically the entire industry had planned, and clearly Nintendo themselves had planned for this to like be something that was coming out either in spring or like summer this year.
Yeah, well, what I heard from the developers that it was supposed to come out at the beginning of March.
Yep.
And this year, and that their games would be playable at the Nintendo booth, and Nintendo was supposed to have this huge booth. But then they traded spots with Pokemon, and Pokemon ended up having the huge booth, and Nintendo had the small booth in the corner.
You have to imagine that was like likely how Visions of Mana was probably going to be promoed.
Yeah. Yeah, it was.
And when that fell through, that was probably how Xbox ended up getting the marketing for it.
Yeah. But a lot of the devs said, and then the Nintendo's console's coming out next March is what they all told me. Is what they've all been told. All their dev kits have been updated. They're the same dev kits, by the way, as the Switch. So they're the same dev kits. They just got an update.
So don't expect a giant boost, essentially.
They said it's about as powerful as a PS4.
I mean, that tracks what we heard. We heard somewhere between like the base PS4 and probably like the PS4 Pro, somewhere in there.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, if you're cramming the PS4 Pro into a device that's going to cost $300, that's incredible.
Yeah.
We've heard similar rumors about Microsoft's plans for a handheld.
Yeah.
Except that they are trying to cram the Series S in. Like, their handheld would obviously be more expensive than Switch.
Yeah.
But that they kind of want to, like, get into that Steam Deck market, which, that's fine. Like, that's who they're targeting anyways.
Yeah.
Two totally different audiences. But, yeah, we had a lot of, like, Switch 2 stuff come out over the weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Like, get confirmed by various folks.
Yeah, well, GDC, right? I had a couple friends at GDC who all they were talking about was Switch 2. All the indie developers and smaller developers I talked to, including one of my favorite games there, their studio director was like, Oh yeah, we already have dev kits. It's like not, it's like the worst kept secret in the entire world.
Right. Which I mean, we knew for a while, like we down to where we basically knew the month it was releasing a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
And then Nintendo was like, nope.
Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah.
I mean, to be fair, like the Switch is still moving so many units right now.
Mm-hmm.
It, even if it is slowing up like a little bit, like it is still the, really them releasing the OLED when they did gave them another like year or two probably.
Yeah.
That and also the decision to do the Switch Lite. Like, I can't tell you how many people I know who have bought Switch Lites for their kids.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Those two moves 100% extended the life of this console because.
Yeah.
Someone was pointing out the other day that we are now, that this, the gap between the Wii releasing and now is bigger than the Super Nintendo to the Wii.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just wild to think about when you think about the technology jump there.
Yeah.
Oh my god,
it's crazy.
Oh my god, like they were like, it was the whole point about like retro gaming because people are like, oh, the Wii and 360 aren't retro. Like, yeah, they are.
Yeah,
they are at this point. Like, I'm sorry if that makes you feel old. They are. Yeah. Those consoles came out, the 360 came out 19 years ago.
Yeah,
it's old enough to vote.
I hate this. I don't like it.
Yeah, Corey's not a fan.
Look, man. Not a fan. The Xbox 360 came out the first year I was in college. Okay, that was
the Xbox 360 came out when I was seeing Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire in theaters.
Oh my gosh, Josh!
So
what are you doing to me, man?
I understand. I still remember seeing Oblivion for the first time in Game Informer. Yeah. But Corey, I'm glad you had a great trip.
Yeah,
glad you got to see Ben Starr's beautiful face.
Oh my gosh, dude, he's a look.
He's a handsome man.
He's a handsome man. Now I'm straight, Josh, but. That guy.
You have some questions.
He's got people thinking some things, okay?
That's fair. I feel the same way.
And his voice does not help change any of that.
No.
No.
So. All right. Corey, we're going to jump into the nitty-gritty of it. We have a lot. We actually have a lot of Destiny to talk about this
week. Yeah, we do. I
flew solo last week talking about that first stream, which is fine because we had just enough content to get in about an hour's worth of a show. Man, this week's stream, definitely like a little bit more low-key because they weren't focusing as much on gameplay, but the entire weapon suite was shown off. 12 weapons are returning from the past. That is better than I hoped for. I had said that realistically I expected 8. Optimistically, I hoped for 10. I did not think we would get 12. This is a list. This list is a choice. And I don't mean that in a negative or a bad way before anybody starts jumping on me about it. I don't think that it's a bad list. I think there are some choices on here, though, that definitely needed to be better. So let's go through. We're going to go through a list of these first, discuss that, and then we're going to break down some of the roles you can get on these, why it's a good thing these are on the list, etc. Forbearance, the ARC wave frame grenade launcher from... the Vow of the Disciple raid. So this is the first startling thing. Raid weapons are a part of this, and raids that are currently still in the game.
Mm-hmm.
So Forbearance is in there. Succession from the Beyond Light Deepstone Crypt raid. Falling Guillotine, the fan favorite Vortex Void Sword from Season of Arrivals. And then, oh boy, just a string of absolute nightmares from PvP players. The Recluse, the beloved Void SMG, the Mountaintop, the old micro missile breech loaded grenade launcher, Hammerhead from the Season of the Forge, it's the only Black Armory weapon coming back. Oh, it's not, because Blast Furnace is back, baby. From the same expansion. It is the most beloved aggressive frame, which is a 4-burst pulse rifle in the game's history. Luna's Howl is back from the old comp days. That launched with Forsaken, if you want an idea of how old this one is. Midnight Coup, Destiny 2, Year 1 from the old Leviathan raid.
Sweet.
Elsie's Rifle from Destiny 1, Stranger's Rifle. We've come to know it as an exotic, as No Time to Explain. But I'm happy that there is a non-kinetic version of this gun coming in. Very excited to see this. And then Edge Transit is back.
Edge
Transit. Not only is Edge Transit back, they've turned it into one of the most powerful heavies in the game. And then,
gosh, how many times have you dismantled Edge Transit?
A lot. I actually love that. I actually love this weapon is back, and I'll tell you why when we get down to it. And then, last and certainly least, the Hung Jury is back.
Hmm.
So, at first glance, this list is awesome. I think this is they really did accomplish the goal that Chris Proctor said, which was, we wanted to get the greatest hits of Destiny, but in including those two raid weapons from raids that are still in the game, they wanted to give folks who don't raid a chance to get some raid weapons. And I mean, listen, of the current raids, you could do a lot worse with reissues than the most popular PvE weapon in the game, Forbearance, and the Succession Sniper Rifle. You could do a lot worse. I would argue, if you wanted to put in a sniper, that maybe Succession isn't the one to do. I do think it has some cool perks on it, though. Upon seeing some of the weapons that they decided not to use, which we have a list. Chris Proctor talked about this. We're going to reference this pod a lot tonight. He did an interview last night on Massive Breakdowns. They said some of the weapons that they decided not to reprise. As soon as I can find the list, God bless America. my page refreshed on me, unfortunately. I gotta find it. Fuck.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I had it. I screenshotted it earlier and forgot to save the screenshot, which is a problem.
How do you forget to save a screenshot?
Because you have the option to copy and delete instead of save it. Fair. On the iPhone. I'm actually... Here we go. Okay. He said on the show that they went through like 100, or he said on the stream, they went through 100 different weapons. He clearly later clarified on last night's show, they had 40 weapon suggestions internally and they cut it down to 12 that they could reasonably make. Cut weapons included Chroma Rush, which really breaks my heart. I would have loved to see that one.
Chroma Rush.
But I think there's enough 720s that I'm okay with it. Also, like, I mean, I guess that would have been like the iconic weapon from Splicer. For me, that more tells me that they're looking at bringing the Splicer armory forward at some point.
Yeah.
Similar to how they did with the Chosen Arsenal. Chroma Rush, First In, Last Out, Dust Rock Blues, 21% Delirium, Fatebringer, Dire Promise, Wastelander, Antiope D, Trophy Hunter, and the Arentil Fusion Rifle. I will say, out of this list, I personally, when I'm looking at these weapons, I would have taken Chroma Rush, Dust Rock Blues, First In, Last Out, Trophy Hunter, or 21% Delirium over Hung Jury. Just straight up, I would have taken any of those.
Yeah.
I would have taken literally any weapon from the Season of Dawn. I'm very surprised they did not revisit that. Like, you're talking fan favorites. I think that's still probably one of the best seasonal suites we've gotten in the history of Destiny 2.
Those weapons were awesome.
Yeah. Patron of Lost Causes. Like, if you wanted a scout, that is literally right there.
Yeah.
That is, and I know that I'm really biased because it is my personal favorite scout in the game. Mm-hmm. That was just a trusty go-to weapon, and it got sunset way too soon. The Breach Light sidearm. Last Hope was a sidearm that season. An Amalon sidearm.
Mm-hmm.
The Amalon Burst. I just think I think those three would have been great weapons to bring back. But I understand. Like, you can't appease everybody. And I think I kind of understand the philosophy behind not using like 21% Delirium, for example. 21 Delirium was so good because it had Killing Tally for the first time, right? That was the first time we'd ever seen that perk. I think that is like kind of rendered moot because that rolls on so many weapons now. And I believe I'm gonna stop myself before I say it. It is on the Hammerhead. So I understand that they've been doing a good job at bringing some of those old Gambit pinnacles back as weapons with random rolls in the Gambit loot pool. So I'm kind of okay with that. Same with if you want to bring back Dust Rock Blues, I'm kind of okay if you want to make that a Shax drop in the future. Reworked a little bit, but I also think like, and they address Not Forgotten specifically. saying that we do have plans for this, but we want to rework it. We didn't want to drop both that and Luna's at the same time. It didn't make a whole lot of sense for us to drop both, but that they are looking at an opportunity to bring it out during the final shape year. Other than that, I mean, I look at the rest of this, and I agree that Fatebringer could have been in there, but at that point you're looking at three hand cannons, and I'm sorry, like, we don't need three kinds of any type of weapon in a single release, even if it's a free release,
right?
And at that, and also, like, for people who are like, oh, I would have rather had Fatebringer, like, cool. Which one are you going to give up out of Midnight Coup and Luna's Howl? Which one are you going to give up? Because I think most folks would rather see those back, or they'd rather see Kindled Orchid from the Black Armory.
Yeah.
And in fact, we only see two Black Armory weapons. Really makes me think that we're going to see a Black Armory refresh at some point. Like, take a combo of, like, Black Armory and Scourge of the Past Black Armory weapons. Kind of, like, take a fusion of those and make them a supplemental arsenal to a season. Like they've done with the Undying weapons. They did with the Menagerie weapons, the Old Reckoning weapons, etc. Like, that and the Saint 14 weapons are really the ones they haven't brought up like that.
Yeah.
The Wastelander, again, that's another one that, like, man, that just came out with the 30th anniversary. Like, I'd be pretty upset to see that re-released already. That's kind of where I came down on a few of these. I personally would swap out, I would have swapped Succession for Trophy Hunter, knowing what we do now, mm-hmm. just because I'm very partial to Trophy Hunter, and I'm a big believer in stories. We were told that, you know, hey, these are weapons that Shax has curated throughout the years and this and that. And I think it would be really cool. Trophy Hunter, if you don't know, is the sniper rifle that the Scions use. And that was one of the cool things in those early couple of in some of those early seasons that they did, is they gave us weapons that looked like the Undying Arsenal, and then Trophy Hunter was a weapon during Dawn that you could get, but you could only get it if you had the season pass. And it was really cool because it gave this idea of, I'm using the enemy's weapons against them. Mm-hmm. And I think that would be so cool. Like, oh, we've got this art. Like, I think it would have been cool to see that and see a splicer weapon in here as, like, oh, the Cabal and the Elixni have offered some of their stuff up to Shax to arm the Guardians.
Yeah.
I think that would have just been so cool. Like, the Black Armory's in on this. Oh, we got Saint 14 contributing. And okay, yeah, we pulled some stuff from the Throne World. You know, we're going to use some of the Witnesses' tech against them. We're bringing back weapons that Shax has literally banned in the Crucible. Like, there's some cool narratives there. And I'm like, I guess I'm like, I'm fine with it. Like, I'm not going to split hairs over, like, Succession is a pretty damn good sniper if you're going to give a sniper to people.
Yeah.
And I understand the philosophy of, we want people to get to enjoy raid weapons who aren't raiding. Maybe it encourages them to go raid. Like, I think that's the ultimate goal here. So that's fine. Yeah, that's fine. I'm not going to sit here and nitpick. Hung Jury is the one that I'm going to get. I'm going to get hung up on it. I'm actually really annoyed by this.
Here's the thing. As a Hung Jury user and a fan of the weapon, I also am kind of like, but why?
This just in, Destiny 2 team has tweeted out. I am very, very happy to get to tell you guys this. They are not drip feeding the weapons anymore. We have reached a compromise. All weapons will be in the loot pool by April 30th.
Yay.
That everything is going to be condensed to drop within those first 3 weeks. We've got updates on the rollout for the Brave Arsenal starting April 9th, plus important call-outs to highlight just how much loot you'll be swimming in during Into the Light. We've seen the feedback on releasing an additional weapon each week after the first 6 drops on April 9th. And we've condensed the schedule to release everything by April 30th rather than May 21st. That gives us a full month to farm absolutely everything. Great. We still think it's important to have fresh rewards to look forward to in the first few weeks. And we want to pack the first half of Into the Light before we introduce more playable content in the second half. I love it. Guaranteed limited edition variants and weapon drop rates. By completing our site's quests, you are granted to get a curated limited edition variant of every weapon. The team has picked hot perk combos for these, and they all come with unique shiny visuals. So even if you don't have a lot of free time, you'll be able to walk out of Into the Light with a limited edition variant of all 12 weapons with excellent rolls and over a month to complete these straightforward quests. Earning your own limited edition God roll is meant to be a very exclusive reward that will require some effort, which is why we wanted to make sure everyone can get at least one awesome limited edition variant of each weapon through these quests. The drop rates during Into the Light will be among our highest in Destiny's history, even harkening back to Season of Opulence. Who remembers those multiple chest runs? Who remembers getting 5 chests at once on multiple chest weekend?
Nice.
By attuning to a specific weapon, we're going to go over like all the specifics of the Hall of Champions. I just feel it's really important to read this at the top of the show so we have some context for what we're going to get to before I complain too much. By attuning to a specific weapon, you will greatly increase your chances of it dropping from onslaught chests, and you'll be opening a lot of chests. Depending on how long you last, expect to earn several drops of the same weapon in a single session, especially on 50 wave runs. You can also use the weapon chest near Shaxx in the Hall of Champions to get more weapons using Trophies of Bravery. These trophies will drop game-wide across rituals, seasonal activities, raids, dungeons, dares, lost sectors, and more. So you will always be earning progress towards more weapons as you're playing. They even drop from onslaught chests. You'll be able to grab a few more rolls after every session. All 12 brave weapons can still be farmed after Into the Light concludes. We'll be moving Onslaught over to a dedicated node in Vanguard Ops with the launch of the final shape, at which point you'll also be able to enhance perks on all of these weapons. And we have even more content to announce for Into the Light next Tuesday. Holy W! Guys, my number one complaints were fucking Hungjury is back for like the 5th time, and that's not an exaggeration, and these weapons are time-gated. My compromise, I was talking with Fox in Discord about, we had a very spirited discussion, a lot of us did about this in Discord earlier. Most of us were like, we're fine with a time gate. We understand that you need those engagement numbers up, and you don't want people to farm everything in 2 days. There are people who will no-life this and then complain a weekend that there's no more content. I understand that struggle from a gameplay and game designer perspective. This was my idea of a compromise. There's supposed to be 3 maps in rotation for this. Just introduce a new map each week and drop 4 more weapons with them. This is awesome. This feels like we're going to get the 6 on... So we're getting the 6 on April the 9th. I want to read this out exactly. We're getting the 6 on April the 9th. And then you've got the 16th, the 23rd, and the 30th. The 30th is the goal to have everything in. I assume we're getting 2 more a week, each week, which it's not 1, but it's 2. So it still is drip-fed, but it gets their numbers up. It gets us back into the game. It's kind of, oh, we're going to dangle the carrot in front of you, but you've got time to farm everything now. So, like, I personally don't care about a lot of the weapons in that first drop. I can exclusively focus in each of those next 3 weeks on the new weapons dropping.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, I could basically just rest soundly knowing that I'm dumping everything into the Recluse on day 1.
Yeah.
I'm dumping it into that. I'm dumping it into Elsie's rifle. I'm getting some Fallen Guillotines going. And I'm ignoring the fuck out of Hungjury. Because for some inexplicable reason, that's the first weapon.
That's in the
first drop.
Why do you think... Now, clearly, this is... Somebody at Bungie thinks this weapon is popular, which...
I mean, it is. It is.
Destiny 1, especially, because, I mean, What's-His-Face was selling the God roll for, like, the first... 6 months that was available, right? Like,
yeah.
I mean, it had like what Firefly and Firefly and something else on it, but like, I don't know, man. Like, why? There's so many cooler weapons than Hungjury, and I'm a Hungjury defender. I love Hungjury. I used to love that weapon, but like, I don't know, man. I just feel like there are better weapons. Anything, yeah, I don't know, man.
I mean they give us an explanation in here, a little bit about Hungjury. I want to scroll down and I'll read that out real quick, because we're going to go through all these weapons and read what they have here. Hungjury was at one time one of the most requested weapons to bring forward from the original Destiny, which we did in Season of the Splicer, but it was only right to include it here again given its legacy. Yes and no. I have a really big problem with weapons that are very easily attainable being a part of this update. And this is the only, to be fair, this is the one that is easily attainable. I have a problem with this. I don't like that I can walk over to Zavala and buy it right now, and it's not like the rolls are bad on it either. Mm-hmm. But it's just like, of all the scouts, this is the one you chose. Like, Patron of Lost Causes is right there. Oxygen SR3 is right there.
Yeah.
Like, there are options if you wanted a scout in there so badly. I mean, Chroma Rush, Trophy Hunter, Ghost Primus. Like, there are other weapons I feel that the fan base wants besides... Like, everybody collectively groaned over this. And, like, I don't want to harp on it too much. It is one weapon out of 12. I think the other 11 are, frankly, fantastic choices. Because all of them have a legacy. And that's the thing, is, like, that's the one reason why I'd be like, well, I'm not too upset with this, because it does have a legacy. I don't know. I guess I think about, like, where scouts are in the meta right now, and like, okay, it doesn't really make sense. I would have loved to have seen, like, you know, I'm going to keep bringing it up, Trophy Hunter. I would have loved to see it. I understand why they went Succession, even if I, like, personally don't agree with it. It is one of the sickest looking designs in the game, though. Like, Forbearance, I mean, that's a top tier ad clear weapon. You got to love it. You absolutely got to love it. So, Let's start with the top of this list, Corey. Let's do it.
All right. Let's
Forbearance. We're gonna talk about some of the roles here. I wanna pull up our questions, because we're gonna go through some of the questions while we're at it.
All right.
Forbearance.
This is the wave frame grenade launcher, correct? Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
This question whole time. Thread. Yes, we have some questions.
I want to weave
a couple of these in. So we got asked this a few times. What are some roles you guys are looking forward to in the Brave Arsenal? Well, lucky for you guys, I think Sammy Dealer and a few others asked this. I want to go through this, because we know every perk right off the bat. Mm-hmm. That's going to roll on these weapons.
Yeah.
And every perk we talk about tonight is enhanceable going forward. So very excited for that.
Should we like go through which perks are the best perks to get on these weapons too?
We're going to read them all off and then give our preferred. I'll say we'll each give a preferred combination. How about that?
Okay.
I mean, I just, this is one of those follow along, guys. Pull this up, follow along with us. I really, really, really want to bring this up. So, I like their explanation of Forbearance right here, that we want all players to experience this so strong it should be an exotic weapon and get a taste of endgame artillery. Mm. We took the time to update the perk pool to include Disruption Break, Demolitionist, and more. That's the cool thing about these two raid weapons, is there are perks on these you cannot get in the raids, mm-hmm. which I think is really cool. So this can roll, and we're not going to call them third and fourth column. We're going to call them first and second. First column, you can get Unrelenting, Stats for All, Demolitionist, Ambitious Assassin, Surplus, Steady Hands, Disruption Break. And the fourth column, you can get Wellspring, Golden Tricorn, One for All, Bait and Switch, Chain Reaction, Rampage, and the new perk, Desperate Measures, which was called Last Stand during the stream that we had the other day.
Did they change the perk name, or
they did change the perk name. Yeah. I forget. Corey wasn't able to watch it live. They did change. They said that they were playing an old build when they showed it to us, mm-hmm. that perk has changed name. But it is, I believe if you are running a light subclass, you dealing damage generates grenade energy. And if you are running a darkness subclass, you generate, melee energy. Mm. That's the origin trait on the guns. Excuse me. That's the origin trait on the Brave Arsenal. This one works very similar to the Golden Tricorn. Let me see if we've got an exact definition of it. They were talking about it last night. I gotta find it real fast. Give me 1 second, guys. I'm so sorry.
You want me to sing a song for them, Josh? You think they
please God, no. Okay, so the new Desperate Measures perk works like an easier to use Golden Tricorn. 10% damage buff on weapon kills, 20% on ability kills, can stack up to 30% if you get both an ability and weapon kill. Lasts 7 seconds, but is refreshable. That is going to be absolutely monstrous on some of these guns. I'm specifically thinking things like Blast Furnace, something in Recluse. Like, that'd be a fun perk to roll around with on some of those. But yeah, this is a really cool new perk. I like that they still found time to bring a new perk in. I have a feeling, considering it's originally called Last Stand, that this was probably supposed to be a perk for the Final Shape, and it just got brought forward.
Yeah.
But hey, kudos to you for getting that perk working in time to ship with this release.
Yeah. Do you think they'll change the name back when the Final Shape comes out, or do you think they're just
This is it. Desperate Measures is still a pretty bitchin' name for a perk, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, I mean, that's fair.
I mean, on this, the easy answer here is Ambitious Assassin Chain Reaction, because that is the one. Mm-hmm. That's the one. That, and I would pretty much guarantee you that's going to be the curated role, because that is the god role of it. So I'm gonna change up a little bit. I'm gonna go Disruption Break Chain Reaction on this. I like the idea of Disruption Break on it. I think that's really cool. It's not something that I personally have used a ton on Wayframes, so I'm very interested to see how that one plays out. Yeah. Also, Desperate Measures could be really spicy on this.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I mean, Chain Reaction is good. I think, man, Desperate Measures just sounds like a cool perk to add to most things, it seems.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically a better Golden Tricorn.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So, I don't know, man. I would probably pick that.
Succession, which is the Deepstone Crypt Sniper Rifle. First column, moving target. No distractions. Lead from gold. Reconstruction. Firmly planted. Demolitionist and Discord. Discord, of course, being one of our newer perks. Fourth column, snapshot sights, redirection, recombination, Vorpal, focused fury, firing line, and boxed breathing. I genuinely, in that second column, I don't think you can go wrong with any of those, depending on what you want to use this for. I personally have reconstruction on mine that I use. I'm actually interested to see reconstruction, recombination. I have not gotten a roll like that. I also really love firing line on snipers. Mm-hmm. I'm never gonna go away from that. I'm mainly looking at it as a PvE context, though.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not thinking about taking this into PvP at all. I'm not a good sniper in PvP. I got very lucky when I did sniping years ago.
And with the new rules,
I definitely don't want to.
As the PvP sniping champion, you know, I just don't take sniper rifles in because it's not fair to anybody else.
I can't stand you. I cannot stand you.
Oh, man. Shotguns all day. Woo!
Shotguns all day. So what would you want on this sniper, Corey?
I mean, firing line, definitely. Although box breathing is pretty... a decent.
I like box breathing. Yeah. I don't know. I don't think it's as good. Like it's
definitely not as good. But
I really like that entire second column.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you can't go wrong with that. I mean, even if Vorpal, like
Vorpal's probably like the one that I wouldn't want.
Yeah,
just because I feel like there's so many better perks. Like I like focused fury, I like firing line, mm-hmm. and probably box breathing all better than that.
Yeah.
Redirection and recombination are those are raid perks, so I'm excited to see. I like those.
Yeah,
obviously. Yeah, succession is this is a dirty one. I'm not thrilled that it's a weapon that's easily attainable, but I do like keeping in mind that folks can't go raid.
Yeah,
like okay, cool.
Yeah.
This is a pretty good sniper and a great perk pool to hand out to folks. Like you can get a great PvE or PvP roll out of this gun.
Yeah.
This is not a sniper where it's one or the other like it has been in the past. Like this is you will be able to get a good roll for either. Yeah. And keep in mind, all these weapons can drop with double perks. So that's even better.
Yeah.
Especially on a gun like this. Let's move on to Falling Guillotine, which was the first legendary Vortex Frame sword. It is, of course, the Child of the Dark Drinker exotic sword from Destiny 1, which is probably why I'm so partial to it. That was my favorite sword. That was my exotic sword in Destiny 1. Mm-hmm. So very, very, very excited of this. This was a boss killer for a long time. We had a sword meta for a good long while. This is an interesting perk pool. So in the first column, you can get, of course, Vorpal, get Relentless Strikes, Repulsor Brace, Frenzy, Attrition Orbs, kind of like Attrition Orbs, Chain Reaction, and Duelist Trance. And on that second column, you can get Surrounded, Whirlwind Blade, Destabilizing Rounds, Eager Edge. I think I just heard Joasis scream in happiness. Bait and Switch, Desperate Measures, and coming over from the Crota Raid. They are taking a raid perk this quickly out of its given raid and putting it on here. You're getting Sword Logic.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I think Sword Logic is going to be really cool on this.
So are they going to... Dumb question, but are they going to add Sword Logic to, like, a lot of swords now? Like, is that...
I don't think so, because, I mean, it's not on a sword yet. This is the first sword it's going to be on.
I know, but I mean, like, moving forward, you think?
They might. I just think this... If you're going to put it on a sword, this is a fitting one to do it on.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really hard because, like, they note here that longtime favorite Relentless Strikes, Whirlwind Blade. That is the role that I have on mine still to this day. I will likely grab another one of those just for kicks and giggles. Mm-hmm. But I'm very excited to try Surrounded Chain Reaction. I know it's listed here, but that is, like, kind of spicy to me, especially if you plan on using it to do some ad clear in some bigger high-end content or some dungeons. I think that could be a really cool thing.
Yeah.
You know, to get some ads and be able to deal massive boss damage. I really do personally like that one. Mm-hmm. I also think Repulsor Brace, Destabilizing Rounds is pretty cool on a sword.
Yeah.
As it's noted here.
Yeah.
I know swords are one of the weapons that I'm not, like, super versed in. So, like, when I find something that works, I stick with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, so, especially because I only use Vortex frames,
yeah,
for the most part.
Yeah. Yeah. Man. Frenzy would be cool. Let's see. I mean, Vorpal on a sword, usually if you're, like, going up against larger enemies, I guess. I don't know. Seems interesting. I'm ready. I'll take a sword.
Yeah, I'm interested. Yeah, I'll bring a sword for Uncle Drifter.
Eager Edge, man. That's
and it's only the second Vortex frame to get it. The other one just came to the game last week with the Slammer.
Yeah.
This next one is the one that I'm most excited about. These next four. These next four are my guns. These are the ones that I'm absolutely leaving here with the coolest versions of every one of these weapons. I'm gonna have multiples of these in my vault. And Datto can't stop me. 100 new vault spaces. Datto can't stop me. Recluse. It has the iconic Master of Arms perk back. That's just automatically, like, that's the god roll. Feeding Frenzy, Master of Arms. That's the god roll. But there are so many other ones that are good. In that first column, Feeding Frenzy, Enlightened Action, Subsistence, Threat Detector, Repulsor Brace, Hip Fire Grip, and Dynamic Sway Reduction. Fourth column, Master of Arms, Target Lock, Frenzy, Destabilizing Rounds, Surrounded, Tap the Trigger, Desperate Measures. Listen, you guys asked what perk combo am I most excited to get. It's easily the Curated Recluse. They're going to hand everybody a Feeding Frenzy, Master of Arms, Recluse. I do not need to emphasize, and they also increased the range on Recluse, by the way. They gave it +6 range, so you're welcome, yes. Everybody. I don't think I need to describe how much of a nightmare the Crucible is going to be when this drops, and I'm okay with it. We now have a top-tier SMG for every single element. We have the Recluse for Void. We have Aikalos SMG for Arc. We have the Immortal for Strand. We have Unwavering Tempest, I think, for Stasis. I believe that's the name of it. It's the Crucible SMG that dropped last season. And then, of course, we have the Kalos mini tool for Solar.
Of course.
That is insane that we have a top tier 900 RPM SMG for every single element. I'm just that's all my energy slots ever going to be from now on. This is crazy. I'm gonna change it up though. I'm not gonna allow myself to say Feeding Frenzy Master of Arms as my preferred combo. I'm not even gonna use either of those. That's my challenge here. I'm gonna say, man, I think I want Subsistence Target Lock on this.
Because
I'm trying to think about it from both a PvP and a PvE perspective.
Josh, thinking really, outside the box.
I really, really love Target Lock. If I can get to, at this point, if I can get Target Lock on a weapon, it's going on it. Like that is, that has to be like the best perk for just about every available gun, short of this one with Master of Arms.
Yeah.
I will absolutely get a roll with Target Lock for sure and keep it because it's maybe the best PvP perk in the game.
Yeah.
Like we've seen it with Immortal. We've seen it with, now we're seeing it with Summoner with 600 RPMs. Yeah. We've seen it with Rufus's Fury. It is, we've seen it with several Trace rifles now. It is such a good fucking perk. It is, I would go so far to say it's probably the best new perk of the Lightfall year.
Yeah.
And I don't even think it's really a question, to be totally honest with you. I'm very, very excited for that. Shout out to old favorites, Dynamic Sway and Tap the Trigger.
Mm-hmm.
Once upon a time, that was the god roll on every SMG, and now I'm like, man, I was excited for that the first time Ikalos SMG came back when it was a prophecy drop.
Yeah,
not so much anymore. Still reliable, but definitely not the one that I'm chasing here. Destabilizing rounds and repulsor brace and destabilizing rounds could be really interesting too, I think.
Yeah, that could
but
be.
But this just looks nasty. Like, again, another one where just about every perk in that second column is worth getting.
Yeah, I think the thing would be pairing the things in that second column with something in the first column, right? I mean, that would be the...
Oh, okay. Really? Really?
Yeah, I mean, I like all the second column stuff. I just feel like maybe, like...
If you're going to pick something out of that first column, what would you...
Oh, want? My God. I mean, Feeding Frenzy is, like, the easy one. But
a Feeding Frenzy Target Lock could be really good. Will be really good.
Here's the thing. I'm a huge fan of Hip Fire Grip, but I also know that this weapon deserves a better second perk or first perk, I guess. Subsistence could be interesting.
I mean, if you want something better than Hip Fire, I would say Dynamic Sway.
Yeah.
I like Dynamic Sway. It's just like, I guess when I'm thinking of like the most potent SMG.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying is like, you want something that's going to do something more interesting than just like not aim down sights. Right. I mean,
especially like if you're going to be like, this is probably gonna be the first time I watch like a God Rolls video in like years, mm-hmm. because you only have a certain amount of weeks to get the special look and get the ornament for these.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I will be getting God Rolls.
Yeah.
But again, like we're getting the curated rolls handed to us also, which is really cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. I really appreciate that.
Yeah. I mean, Feeding Frenzy, I think in that first column, probably.
I mean, that is the best one.
Yeah.
I was trying to challenge myself to think of something else. Like, I mean, Subsistence, Dynamic Sway, Repulsor Brace, those are all good. I don't use Enlightened Action a ton, so I can't really speak to it. But God, that fourth column is so good.
Yeah.
Like, when Tap the Trigger is probably, like, the least, one that you want the least, like, you know it's a great perk, great perk row. Yeah. This is one I want double perks on. I want to be able to swap between, like, the God Roll and some of these other perks at will.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, Corey, let's talk about the other one that's getting random rolls for the first time ever.
Mountaintop.
I'm so excited for Mountaintop. Micro Missile is now a frame.
Jesus.
They did confirm, Chris Proctor did confirm last night, they will introduce other Micro Missile breech-loaded grenade launchers at some point, but they want Mountaintop to shine for a while first. They have not taken away any of its potency in PvE. They have nerfed it pretty strongly for PvP. Because it's funny how they talk about both Recluse and Mountaintop. With Recluse, they say Recluse remains an extremely potent option in PvP and PvE. With Mountaintop, they say we did not want to return to the days of Mountaintop PvP meta, so we rebuilt Micro Missile, retaining its PvE strength but with decreased self damage and a massively increased physics impulse. Hilarity will ensue. Jesus Christ, man. This first column, Ambitious Assassin, which already on a breach loader is just a phenomenal choice. Impulse Amplifier, Demolitionist, Lead from Gold, Slick Draw, Auto-Loading Holster, and Overflow. Fourth column, you can get Rampage, Vorpal, Adrenaline Junkie, One for All, Harmony, Recombination, and Frenzy. Wow.
I mean, yeah. I mean, I feel like this is going to be all over the place as well, I feel like.
I think combining Recombination on this with a weapon like the Recluse is going to be nuts. So, like, Recombination, if I remember correctly, is elemental kills give your next shot with this weapon 10% more damage.
Yeah.
And it stacks up to 10 times.
Jesus Christ.
The Mountaintop is about to be a top tier raid weapon again. I look at this and I go, okay, for me, for my personal playstyle, I really want Impulse Amplifier or I want auto loading in that first slot. I wouldn't mind Overflow. I would not mind Overflow at all, especially in a raid situation.
Yeah.
For me, those three are pretty, for my specific playstyle, I know Slick Draw, Demolitionist, and Ambitious are all going to be top options as well. For my personal playstyle, I like Impulse Amplifier on the Micro Missile.
Mm-hmm.
That fourth column, it's funny because I feel like the fourth column is the one, like, this is the first time that we're like, oh, okay, we can kind of breathe in the second column. It's all in the first column this time.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I'm looking at this and I'm going, it's not a sexy choice, but Vorpal. I really like Recombination and I love the idea of Frenzy.
Yeah.
Impulse Amplifier Frenzy on this could be awesome. Ambitious Assassin Frenzy could be really good. I know there's some folks who are going to really like Adrenaline Junkie. Rampage is going to be good. I mean, it's still going to be good, but that first column is where I think like the key perk is going to come from.
Yeah.
On this one.
Yeah, and it's going to change depending on if you're doing, like you said, your playstyle and PvP.
Yeah. How aggressive do you want to be?
Yeah.
Do you want something that's going to work in both? Which is kind of how I'm looking at it. Like, oh, I want something that's going to work in both.
Yeah.
I've loved Impulse since it came into the game. I think it's a great perk for grenade launchers and rocket launchers.
Yeah. I mean, for my playstyle, it'd probably be something like Overflow and Vorpal or maybe Rampage or something.
Yeah. Overflow or Rampage would probably be pretty good for how you like to play.
Yeah.
I cannot wait to see the wacky things you can do with it. You can rocket jump with this thing now.
Yeah.
It's absolutely wild. It's speed runs are going to be changed forever with this gun. We've got the Hammerhead coming back, which of course was the first legendary LMG introduced to Destiny 2 and remains arguably its best. That first column, Feeding Frenzy, Destabilizing Rounds, Envious Assassin, Rampage, Fourth Times the Charm, Rewind Rounds, and Under Over. The second column, you can get Surrounded, High Impact Reserves, Target Lock, Onslaught, Killing Tally, Desperate Measures, and Tap the Trigger. There's like three different roles I want to try on this.
Yeah, these, I don't, man.
For me, I think I'm going to go my ideal one that I want the most is probably Fourth Times Killing Tally or Fourth Times Target Lock. I really like both of those. Feeding Frenzy Target Lock or Feeding Frenzy Killing Tally could be really, really cool. I know they say here specifically Rampage Killing Tally and Rampage Desperate Measures.
Mm-hmm.
This is one where like I legitimately think like every single perk on both sides is so Onslaught is filthy. Putting Onslaught on this should be a war crime.
What would you put with it?
No, like in the best way, like Bungie should be tried for war crimes because there are going to be atrocities committed with this gun running Onslaught. That is, for those who don't know, Onslaught is the old Breakneck perk, which now is on everything. It's rolled on a few different things. I'm gonna get a definition of this pulled up for us. Weapon kills grant a stack of Onslaught for 4.5 seconds, maximum of 3 stacks. Which increases, it decreases your firing delay and increases your reload speed for the stacks. So this thing is an absolute workhorse. It's why John loves Breakneck so much, and now they put this on a few different guns. So that's going to be absolutely filthy. What are you thinking here, Corey? You're muted.
Sorry. My son's toy went off over there, and I was like,
oh, okay.
What's going on over there?
You're good. You're good.
Yeah. So, man, you're selling me on Onslaught, man. Like,
Onslaught's cool. It says a lot, I think, that like Onslaught is such a cool perk, and it's like not in my top three things that I want on this gun right now.
Yeah. I mean...
I mean, it's pretty close.
Yeah.
I would say it's probably third on my list. I want Killing Tally Target Lock before it in that second column.
Yeah. I mean, fourth time. Yeah. I mean,
yeah. If I'm thinking about it from a PvE perspective, which of course I am, yeah. I want like fourth time's Killing Tally is going to be insane.
Yeah. That
Target Lock for that boss DPS, Target Lock.
Yeah. I would say, yeah, that's what I would be going with too.
All right, guys, it's time.
Blast Furnace.
It's time. It is time for a weapon that I thought was never coming back. It is maybe my favorite primary of all time. I did not believe it until they actually said the words out loud. I saw the key art like everyone else, and for 2 weeks I waited with bated breath to see if it was going to happen. Blast Furnace is back. It is a four-burst pulse rifle, for those who don't remember. Not the first, certainly the most beloved. Oh boy, I am.
You all right, Josh?
Oh, I'm so excited. Man, Jesus Christ, I really can't believe that I live in a world where this is back with some filthy rolls. In this first column, you can get Zen Moment, Snapshot, Shoot to Loot, Keep Away, Perpetual Motion, Kinetic Tremors, and Head Seeker. In the second column, you can get Kill Clip, Firefly, One for All, Frenzy, Rampage, Rapid Hit, Desperate Measures. This is another one where I'm going to probably have multiple rolls of this gun.
Yeah. What was before these happened, what was the god roll on this? Is Headseeker one of them?
I don't actually I haven't broken this out of my vault since they sunset it because I couldn't bring myself to.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see if I can log into DIM real fast. If I can log into DIM, I can tell you what I had on mine.
I mean, it's no big deal. I just
I want to know what I had on mine.
I'm just curious because it's been a while. It's been a while. Jeez.
I'll tell you right now, I'm absolutely going for a Zen Moment Rapid Hit on this, and I'm definitely I mean Kinetic Tremors Firefly is filthy, Headseeker Kill Clip is filthy. This is another one where I think I like every single perk in that fourth column.
I would be going for that. I'm a huge fan of Firefly, so that's what I'd be going for because I like watching people's heads explode when you shoot them. That's just okay. Me.
My old Blast Furnace had Headseeker Outlaw.
Yeah, that's I knew Headseeker was like the perk people wanted on it.
Yeah, that was my old one. Headseeker Outlaw was my old one. So I cannot get that same one, but I can get pretty damn close.
Let's get Headseeker Firefly on this guy.
Headseeker Firefly, Headseeker Kill Clip, Headseeker Rampage, Rapid Hit. Headseeker Rapid Hit is one that I would like. I really like Zen Moment on scoped weapons, though.
Yeah.
I mean, I like Zen Moment on a lot of things, frankly. But I'm very... God, I can't wait to play with, like, 16 different rolls of this gun. That's why I need Blast Furnace to be in, like, that first update. And then I need it to be, like, that and a hand cannon. So that I just have a whole week of doing nothing but playing with Blast Furnace rolls.
Mm.
At the risk of talking about it all night, I'm going to move on. Edge Transit, it's a meme, but they specifically say it was such a persistent meme we couldn't resist including it and turning it into one of the strongest grenade launchers in the entire game with a greatest hits of grenade launcher damage perks and a particularly spicy option of cascade point.
Cascade point.
They say they specifically brought the buff for drum grenade launchers forward.
Oh god.
They specifically brought it forward for this gun. So that first column can roll chain reaction, cascade point, impulse amplifier, field prep, auto loading, envious assassin, repulsor brace. It's just absolutely filthy. Jeez. The second column, frenzy, destabilizing, deconstruct, adrenaline junkie, bait and switch, full court, explosive light. Man, cascade point, bait and switch is probably fixing to be the best weapon in the game, like the best heavy.
Yeah.
Maybe the best heavy grenade launcher. I'll never say no to chain reaction on a
yeah. I mean,
drum grenade launcher,
if you're doing ad clear in
like yeah, they do say some of those potent ad clear in the game is going to be chain reaction destabilizing rounds.
That's what I was thinking in my head.
Cascade point bait and switch is an easy one for the damage. Also means you don't have to go farm that trials heavy grenade launcher anymore. I'm very curious to see what they're going to do for the curated role on this gun.
Yeah, that'd be interesting.
This is another one where, like, I don't want to keep a bunch of these, but I want to get a role where I have great damage perks for multiple situations in PvE.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be able to switch to ad clear if I need to on it, or if I want single target damage. I really like the addition of full court. I like full court. I'm a big fan of full court. Impulse is kind of boring, but it works. It's tired and true. Also, full court cascade point could be a play here if these bosses keep staying away from us. I would be more excited if we were still in the era of bosses standing like 300 feet away from us. Because full court, of course, you know, does more damage the further it flies, and impulse makes things fly faster. So,
mm-hmm.
Love that combo.
Yeah.
Explosive light is on here. Low key. I feel like we've started to underappreciate explosive light. I do really like it.
Yeah, it's a fun one.
These next two are ones that I don't feel like Corey and I are really like super qualified to talk about. Neither one of us are huge hand cannon guys. So, I would encourage you to go listen to literally anybody else who talks about weapons on these.
Yeah.
But, we're going to break them down anyways. Luna's Howl. Oh boy.
Oh boy.
Originally, this was a precision 180 RPM hand cannon, and the Magnificent Howl perk would let you two-tap on follow-up kills in PvP, driving massive amounts of players to engage with competitive PvP when it launched as a pinnacle. The blistering fast time to kill was a bit over the top for the amount of effort the weapon required, so we reduced its rate of fire and redesigned the perk to have a higher reward for more effort than the original. For this iteration, we've kept it as a precision frame 140 RPM hand cannon and redesigned the Magnificent Howl perk. This will allow for those two taps, but with more effort required, and the precision frame will still make it very easy to control. So then that first column, you're going to get Eye of the Storm, Subsistence, Discord, Encore, Slide Shot, Enlightened Action, and Heel Clip. Heel Clip on this is fucking filthy, by the way. And then in the other one, Magnificent Howl, Kill Clip, Incandescence, Desperate Measures, Opening Shot, Precision Instrument, Harmony. This is another one. This is just like Recluse. Like you want the Magnificent Howl. That's the whole reason you're getting this gun.
Mm-hmm.
You want Magnificent Howl. Take your pick for that first one. I know that some people are really going to like Subsistence and Eye of the Storm. Slide Shot is probably going to be really popular. I think Heel Clip is really intriguing to put on this. Not gonna lie, I think that could be really cool and make it like just as potent in PvE as well, possibly. I don't have a lot to say on this gun. Yeah. I've been terrorized by it. Well, I was terrorized by it long enough. I'm preparing to get terrorized by it again. I'm not a hand cannon expert, though. I'm just gonna be real with you guys.
Yeah.
When this drops, I promise we will get somebody who's good with hand cannons on to talk about it.
Yeah. Not a hand cannon guy. I'm not gonna lie.
All right, then we're just going to move on to Midnight Coup.
Yeah.
Midnight Coup, beloved Leviathan weapon. In that first column, you're going to get Outlaw, Firefly, Shoot to Kill, Explosive Payload, Moving Target, Attrition Orbs, and Enlightened Action. And in that second column, you're going to get Rampage, Kinetic Tremors, Zen Moment, One for All, Frenzy, Opening Shot, and Desperate Measures.
Hmm.
I mean, I think they give you two really cool options here. The original super powerful combo was Outlaw Rampage. They also note Firefly Kinetic Tremors for PvE and Moving Target Zen Moment for PvP.
Yeah.
I think Explosive Payload is going to be a little spicy on this gun.
Yeah, I was going to say, I kind of want to try out Explosive Payload.
I'm interested in Explosive Payload. Maybe Explosive Payload Frenzy, Explosive Payload Opening Shot could be interesting.
That would be spicy.
I like the idea of Explosive Payload Kinetic Tremors for PvE content.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. Let's talk about a gun that we're much more taken with, Corey, and that we're tired of seeing.
I see.
Hung Jury.
Taken with.
Rewind rounds, Enlightened Action, Kinetic Tremors, Rapid Hit, Shoot to Loot, No Distractions, and Loose Change in that first column. That second column is One for All, Cascade Point, Box Breathing, Firefly, Precision Instrument, Desperate Measures, Explosive Payload. I mean,
Firefly or Explosive Payload are the perks that I would want on this.
Can't you already get the Kirk McFarlane, can't you already get those on Hung Jury?
You can. I have Firefly on my Hung Jury.
That's disgusting.
Yeah, with what else is on my Hung Jury? I don't remember. I
have one with Frenzy Rapid Hit.
Yeah.
I have one with, well, this one you can't get anymore, Wellspring Heating Up.
Yeah.
Oh my god, I've got five Hung Juries throughout characters in my vault. Firefly Subsistence, and then my two Adept ones, I've got Explosive Payload Rapid Hit on one of my Adepts, and then on my other Adept, I've got Box Breathing Rapid Hit. I'm not even going to grind one of these out.
Yeah, no.
I'll take the Curated Roll and toss it in my vault and discard one of the standard ones that I have, I guess.
Yeah, Rapid Hit Firefly, I think is what I have on mine.
Yeah. I mean, again, like, it's Old Faithful for a reason, but
this
is the most underwhelming perk pool of them to me personally.
Yeah, this seems pretty, honestly, kind of seems kind of standard for this weapon the most part.
If you were going to give this to me, at least give me a different gun.
Yeah, I love Hung Jury just as much as the next person, right? But like, there are better scouts out there now, and there are more memorable weapons than Hung Jury now out there. I think the only reason why I think this is in here is because they needed a weapon from the Taken King, and the raid weapons were the most memorable. And so they needed something that people also remembered from that. And I think Hung Jury, just because of the god role that was being sold at the vendor.
I think it's dumb. I'm trying to
qualify it in my head here, John.
I was too. I don't know. I even tried being like, well, maybe they wanted something from the Vanguard. And like, well, even if you're doing that, like, I mean, Made Ingredient would have been the one to bring, or Loaded Question would have been the one to bring forward then.
Yeah.
But that just got put back in the game like a year ago, so.
Yeah. I don't know.
And I was like, oh, well, maybe they want the factions represented somehow. It just doesn't sit right with me.
Yeah, I don't know. This
one that does sit well with me, though, Corey.
Elsie's Rifle.
Elsie's Rifle, baby. Stranger's Rifle. That first column, we got Feeding Frenzy, Zen Moment, Repulsor Brace, Loose Change, Keep Away, Under Over, and Rewind Rounds. And the fourth column, you're going to get that Adrenaline Junkie, Frenzy, Destabilizing Rounds, Kill Clip, Desperado, Desperate Measures, Head Seeker. I really like the idea of Feeding Frenzy Desperado this, like Zen Moment Desperado.
Yeah, I was going
for Frenzy
Desperado. Sounds fun.
Yeah. I mean, Rewind Rounds, Kill Clip could be interesting.
Yeah.
This is one that I think I want to try. I'll definitely try Head Seeker out on this, but it's got Desperado, so I feel like that's probably going to be in the curated role.
Yeah.
I'd love to be wrong. This will be one of the weapons that drops right away, by the way, so that's really cool.
I'll be looking for this one. For sure.
Yeah, the first six that are going to drop on April 9th are Recluse, Hung Jury, Succession, Edge Transit, Elsie's Rifle, and Falling Guillotine. So I mean, I guess I'm grinding out Recluse, Elsie's Rifle, and Edge Transit that first week.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I guess I'm prioritizing like weapons that I like don't already have good rolls of.
Yeah,
I still have my Falling Guillotine is still good.
Yeah,
like.
Yeah,
I'll probably go get the same roll with the special look and the special ornament, but it's still good.
Yeah.
And I want to see how they do 2-2 and 2.
Yeah.
So interested to see how that goes. I really like this drop. I'm a big fan.
Yeah. Yeah, I like
that. I'm a very big fan of this.
Happy to get a legendary version of this weapon.
Very happy to get a legendary version of this. I wanted to read some of the... Dealer asks, out of all the weapons that were shown, what are you most excited for? Personally, I'm excited for Edge Transit. Joe jokingly answered this for me and said my answer was going to be Blast Furnace. Blast Furnace is damn near my answer, but man, Recluse.
Yeah.
Recluse and Mountaintop. I'm so excited to see Mountaintop with random rolls.
Yeah.
Those are the three I'm most excited for, probably. Mm-hmm. But I'm excited to get almost every one of these.
Yeah. Yeah. No.
There's at least six of these that I am like, because I'm not big on hand cannons, and three of these I already have the attainable god rolls.
Yeah.
So the other weapons I'm here for. I'm totally here for these.
Yeah. I'm let's see. Recluse is definitely one I want to look at. I want a Blast Furnace. I'll probably chase. Elsie's rifle, I will definitely be chasing. I mean, those are kind of the ones for me. So yeah. But like you said, like my Fallen Guillotine is like, I have the role on Fallen Guillotine, so I don't need to go chase one.
Yeah, but I'm very interested to see if the roles surpass that this time.
Yeah.
No, that's fair. But I feel like there's also a reason why both of those perks are still on here.
Yeah.
I
can't wait to dismantle Edge Transit 7,000 times.
I mean, you have the option to not focus it. I guess that was it, because we kind of answered Sammy's as we were going along.
Yeah.
We did answer roles we're looking forward to and guns we wish had made the cut. Let's talk about this social space a little bit.
Yeah,
the Hall of Champions.
Hall of Champions.
I think this is really cool. The description says, within its walls, the weapons and armor of champions past and present lie dormant, waiting for those worthy enough to wield them, or that's what Lord Shax told us, at least. I think that this is very, very, very cool. This is where you go to earn rewards for playing Onslaught. Shax will be there to welcome you and provide the quest to earn your first brave weapons. Our site will have bounties for Onslaught, as well as a very special vanity reward once you have unlocked all the brave weapons. And it is the long-requested, long-awaited, and hoped-for Super Black Shader, which kind of makes that Festival of the Lost memento useless.
Mm-hmm.
But whatever. They wanted it. Increase Shax's hype, which is tied to playing Onslaught and completing bounties. And at the same time, you'll complete ranks and earn new trophies of bravery, which will serve to unlock a very special armor set reminiscent of the beginnings of Destiny 2. Titans, Warlocks, and Hunters will each have their own group of chests with a curated roll of each armor piece. This armor is meant to be inspired by the parade armor from the Destiny 2 concept art and from the armor you get at the very beginning of Destiny 2 vanilla.
Mm-hmm.
I think the Hunter set is fine. I've seen there's apparently been some complaints that it's too asymmetrical. I don't care. I think it looks good. I like the Warlock set. I'm absolutely in love with the Titan set. I love the Titan set. I like it's fairly minimalistic for a Titan set, and I really like that. Those shoulders in particular, I'm here for it.
Yeah.
I'm gonna have to go get this set on my Titan.
Yeah.
I think this is awesome. I better not hear one goddamn word out of your mouth about how you don't like it.
I didn't say I didn't like
it. I was waiting for it. I was waiting for it.
I kinda like it. The shoulders, come on though. Like,
I love it. I absolutely love it. I think it looks so good.
The shoulders.
I think this set looks fantastic.
I mean, I think they all look pretty good. The Warlock is like, I don't know what's happening with the Warlock.
The Warlock is a little weird. I'll give you that. It looks like something's like plugging into his nipples.
Yeah.
It's a little weird. A little weird for me, but I'll allow it.
I have nipples, Greg. Can you milk me?
That I don't even want to know. I'm really on the Hunter. I really like the helmet, although it's reminiscent of like five other helmets we have already. And I like the chest piece. I like the vest.
Yeah, it's cool.
No, I'm not one for gaudy capes. We all know this.
It's true.
But I do like it. Everyone is welcome to visit the Hall of Champions and explore every corner of it. We've been told there are a few secrets to discover. There have been a few things found already. So when we're walking through it in the dev stream, we see there are, this is where they keep decorations for all the holiday events, which I thought was a fun little nod. An eagle-eyed viewer also spotted during the stream, there are grimoire cards to pick up.
Ooh. Yay.
I don't know if you guys know how I feel about lore, but so help me God, if I have to go read these on Bungie.net, I might actually throw something.
You already have to watch the cutscenes there.
I will actually scream if I have to go out of game to read these. I think it would be very funny, like the very first one you get, they tell you to do that, and it's like, haha, got you.
Yeah.
That was the most exciting thing for me to hear, and I'm convinced there's going to be some cosmetics and stuff they haven't told us about.
Yeah.
I think this is very cool, though. I like the idea. A little bit bummed that it's not the Destiny 1 tower. I was really hoping for it. I'm absolutely convinced that it has to be in the final shape then, because it's so prominent in the key art for Into the Light. Mm-hmm. It is the statue in the collector's edition, which mine should be here sometime tomorrow. So I'm very excited.
Mine was delivered today. But the thing
is... Oh, good for you. Mine's stuck in Georgia.
Well, here's the thing. Since we were moving...
Oh, went to your old address.
Yeah. No, it went to... I shipped it to my parents' house.
Oh.
Just in case.
Fair.
So I was gonna show it off tonight, but I forgot that I did that, and then I got sad. But anyways,
I'm very excited.
I know.
I'm very excited for this.
It feels like, I don't know, man. It feels like the end.
It does feel like the end. It feels like it's kind of setting in that, like, I think they understand that it's happening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know if you've been seeing a lot of like devs from Bungie have been tweeting out, like, you know, they're proud of the final shape and like, it's, you know, this is the end of an era and all these other things. Right. Like, I don't know. It's kind of bittersweet. Right. I mean, like, Destiny has just been in our lives for so long. I mean, I don't know. I'm not going to get nostalgic here. We'll wait. We'll wait on that.
Yeah, we'll save waxing poetic for after the campaign and after the raid. Mm-hmm. What I don't like is I've seen a lot of devs be very happy about the work that they're doing specifically on Into the Light right now. And the members of this community who are just like, well, fuck you, Bungie hasn't delivered on anything in a long time. This is disappointing. It's just a reskin. Like, shut the fuck up. They did not have to give this to us. This did not have to be done. This is a free update. This is about as good as you were going to get. This is more than I expected to get in at a little event leading up to the final shape. The fact that we're getting back all these requested weapons, we're getting a brand new mode to play around, and even if it is just, you know, using assets that exist, that's how you build free content. You use existing assets.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know why it's such a big deal when Destiny does it, but we don't blink an eye when literally any other game does this. Nobody blinks an eye. It's very weird that Destiny and, like, to an extent, like, Bethesda games are, like, the two, like, Bungie and Bethesda are, like, the two that people have chosen to zero in on with that.
Yeah.
It's very weird to me. It's almost uncomfortable. Yeah. Like, I just don't understand it. I don't know how, with the updates they gave us tonight, I don't know how you can be upset with the rollout of this. I don't know how you can be upset with what we're getting, the weapon suite that we're getting. You can be a little upset about Hung Jury, sure. Like, I mean, I am, but it's, like, also, like, kind of just a joke. Like, I am genuinely tired of this gun getting reprised. But, like, 1 out of 12 guns, okay, you have the option to not focus it. Go get your god roll, throw it in your vault, and shut the fuck up. Like... We don't need, you know, soliloquies about this for the next 2 months, you know?
Right.
I would hope this is the final word on seeing some of these guns, though. I hope that this is the last time that we get Hung Jury. This should be the only time that those raid weapons appear outside of their respective raids. Yeah. I don't know. It's kind of how I feel. They did mention on Massive Breakdowns, they had conversations about, do we need to turn Recluse and Mountaintop and maybe, like, Midnight Coup, I think, and or Lunas into, like, exotics to bring them back. Mm-hmm. And they were like, no, because, like, then that would actually require a lot more work, frankly. And they wanted to keep, like, that legendary power fantasy.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's really cool. I think it's really, it's good to know that and acknowledge your audience, too.
Mm-hmm.
They have said that next week we are going to get, we're going to see the three new PvP maps in action. So I'm interested to see how those look and play out, because we haven't seen anything on those. And then they said we're going to see exotic missions, which now is confirmed to be two reprise missions. Of course, everybody is on their hands and knees hoping and praying for Whisper and Zero Hour, because they say they're fan favorite missions. I cannot help but brace myself for the possibility that it is Bad Juju and Hawk Moon instead. Especially considering they've already said Hawk Moon would get random rolls at some point. Well, it has random rolls now, but the mission is no longer in game. They said it would be craftable, etc. I can't help but feel that that's one of them. Which, yeah. Whatever. Like, all four of those missions are going to be back at some point. Mm-hmm. But I can't help but think that Hawk Moon will be one, especially given Crow's seeming importance to the end game of the final shape.
Yeah. Yeah, this is yeah.
And then they said they're gonna have some other surprises next week. So I'm a little interested to see what they do. They also have something called it's a PvE thing called the oh God, what was it called? I gotta find it here. Where did they say it? They said something. I want to say it was the Pantheon. Is what it was called? Is that what it was? I fucking saw it somewhere and I don't know where it is. Bungie said it today, but like I think it's called the Pantheon. It's a new PvE thing. Yeah, there we go.
Yep.
Return to two classic exotic missions, preview the three new PvP maps arriving in May, a new PvE challenge we call Pantheon, and more. We got asked by somebody what missions did we think we were going to get. Sammy also writes in and asks, any predictions on the surprises they're talking about for next week's stream? I really think it's just gonna be like showing us maybe some of the cosmetics, maybe hawking some Eververse crap at us. I really can't think it's like too much. Maybe we get a surprise Vidoc of the final shape.
Yeah.
That's wishful thinking on my part, but I think they're gonna save that for the morning of April 9th. I think they're going to drop something that morning, because they said that we would see the final shape again in April. And at that point, we're just under 2 months out from launch. We'll be about 7 weeks out, seven, 8 weeks, something like that.
Yeah.
So I got to think that they're going to show it pretty soon, because pre-orders have not even gone back up on the digital storefronts yet.
Yeah.
So they're going to have to do that pretty soon. That would be my only guess, is that maybe we get a Vidoc for the final shape.
I would assume we would get something, even if it's little, even if it's small, right? I
mean, mm-hmm.
That would be my assumption.
Let's do questions, Corey. Let's do the rest of these questions. We got a lot of them.
Question time.
The dealer asks, how long do you guess Tuesday's reset will be? My guess is an extra 4 hours total. I don't know, like, are you asking this because there's been some extra downtime lately, or because you think Into the Light's coming out? Into the Light's still a week off. I would say the week that drops, you're probably looking at a 4 hour downtime.
Yeah.
This next week, I'm going to say maybe like an extra hour, like something's inevitably going to go wrong on the back end. It just is what it is. That was the risk that they're doing with pushing stuff out like the day of, instead of building it up in the database over the weekend.
Yeah.
So that we don't have these like crippling, oh, we got to take it down for 12 hour incidents again.
Yeah.
I want to hit the Destiny questions first. Jiggly Panda writes in, do you think we'll get anything from Destiny 1 in Into the Light? They keep emphasizing the Brave arsenal, yet it doesn't seem so powerful. So we're getting Elsie's rifle, but I'm telling you right now, man, like this is a powerful arsenal.
Mm-hmm.
If you did not play in Forsaken, you... And I don't mean this condescendingly at all. If you were not around for the year of Forsaken, you might not quite understand. But, like, legitimately, you are looking at, like, at least four of the strong... Five, I would say. Five of the strongest weapons they've ever put into PvE or PvP.
Mm-hmm.
Between Midnight Coup, Luna's Howl, Recluse, Mountaintop, and Hammerhead.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there was a time when two competitive PvP rewards were the meta... for both PvE and PvP for about a year-long span, despite multiple nerfs to both. Mm-hmm. Recluse and Mountaintop could not be topped. So there was once upon a time, Recluse, Mountaintop, and Swarm of the Raven was the god loadout. And that feels insane to say out loud right now. Mm-hmm. But no, I absolutely think this is a stupid good arsenal. Like, if you've never played around with Prime Recluse and Mountaintop, and you haven't bought them from the kiosk yet, like, let me tell you, you're in for a treat. You're in for a treat. You'll get it. Like, they're going to be nerfed down from their original heights, but even in a new sandbox, these weapons are still going to absolutely shred PvE content.
Yeah.
And I would say I would be more concerned about Mountaintop coming back if they hadn't just changed special ammo rules. And I genuinely think that Mountaintop coming back is what made them change special ammo in the Crucible. But yeah, this is called the Brave Arsenal for a reason. I totally believe, like, we just went over, like, almost every single perk on these weapons is, like, would be a must-have on any other gun.
Yeah.
And the fact that they're shipping so many of these great perks on every gun, one, is a testament to how good the sandbox is, I think, with perks. Two, how hard it is to differentiate between certain guns. But also, three, just, like, the creativity that you can come up with build crafting. Mm-hmm. I'm very, very, very excited. I'm not saying this like out of nostalgia's part. This is on paper, like not even on paper, like we've seen all these weapons perform before. This is the best arsenal we've probably ever gotten for a release, and it's a free release. Like, I can't think of the last time that we got 12 weapons, or we arguably got 10 or 11 must-have weapons in a single release. Like, I can't think of one. Maybe if you combine, like, raid, season...
Yeah, you're going to have to combine event.
You have to combine, like, multiple avenues to maybe get there.
Yeah.
And even then, it still would pale in comparison to the firepower that we're being given.
Yeah,
it fits thematically for these to come back to, like, hey, these are some of the best weapons we've ever had. Mm-hmm. Go crazy.
Yeah.
Tiger Jesus writes in, when Bungie previews episodes, do you want a full Vidoc, or would you rather have 3 or 4 mini streams like they're doing for Into the Light?
Honestly, I just want them to tell me what the fuck they are. I'm like...
So there's that. I personally think for episodes, just give me a Vidoc.
Yeah.
The streams, I think, work for when you're previewing big content or when you have to build hype for a release like this. Mm-hmm. You have like a brand new... I think it works when you have a brand new mode to show. Unless they show us something jaw-dropping next week, there's no reason that we couldn't have done this in 2 streams. I understand why you've done at least 2. I now get it. Yeah. They're going to show us more last week, I think, and then, you know, all the racist fucking names started rolling in. Mm-hmm. I would like a Vidoc, like, and a stream, maybe, like, if you've got something cool to show us, but I understand why they don't usually stream stuff for us, because there's important story context that's in there, and they want us to discover that for ourselves.
Yeah. I mean,
it's like, I get it.
I wouldn't mind with them doing what they've been doing these last couple weeks, to be honest. But, you know, obviously, like, gameplay would be minimal, but I don't know.
I think it's cool to hear from the people that make the game, mm-hmm. instead of it just being like, oh, it's a community manager and, like, Pete Parsons.
Yeah.
Like, it's, you know, their communications director, and he's had different people in there each week.
Also,
like, specifically Noah being in there was really awesome. Like, if you're gonna demonstrate gameplay, get Noah in there from now on.
Yeah. Also, like, it also depends on what happens in the final shape and what the context of the story is happening afterwards, right? Because, like, I feel like, including people that I talk to at PAX, it just feels like a lot of people are checking out after the final shape, right? After that raid comes out, everybody's like, this might be my out point. I don't know, right? And I mean, we've had light discussions about that, about how hardcore we're going to go after the final shape. But, like, that's the thing, is that what's the context of the final shape story and what's going on afterwards? And then, you know, then we can talk about, like, oh, well, Vidocs, streams, whatever.
Yeah. I also think, like, at this point, just, like, save the Vidocs for like when you do Destiny 3.
Yeah.
Or save the streams for when you do Destiny 3 and you got to show off a bunch of new stuff.
Yeah.
That's my personal thought. Jiggly Panda also asks, what is a moment in Destiny that made you go holy shit and made your jaw drop? I mean, we've had a lot of them. I'm gonna think back to the whole franchise. I mean, I think the whole opening cutscene of the Taken King mm-hmm. with the Awoken fleet attacking Oryx,
yeah,
is definitely one. The death of Cade Six.
I mean, go back to the Taken King. Oryx climbing up the side of the ship is the boss battle in the raid. That was cool.
Yeah, that seeing like the sheer like the true size of Oryx for the first time mm-hmm. was awesome.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, the opening cutscene of Destiny 2 is pretty badass too. And like,
yeah, I think the opening cutscene of, I think Gaul kicking us off the ship is cool. Mm-hmm. For me, the one that sticks with me is Shadowkeep. I was not excited to go back to the moon. I still hate the moon. I still hated it in that moment. But when you're going and you're trying to get to Eris and you turn the corner and you see a pyramid ship, mm-hmm. That was a true holy shit moment.
Yeah.
That was not expected. That was not leaked.
Yeah.
Nobody saw that one coming.
Yeah.
That is, I think, probably the most unexpected moment in Destiny history.
Yeah. I don't think we can get out of this question without mentioning the spacewalk in the Deepstone Crypt.
Spacewalk in the Deepstone Crypt. That's a jaw-dropping sequence. It's probably the best sequence of any gameplay that you go through in the game. My only other one I would have is learning that Savathun was going to steal the light.
Yeah.
Or that she stole the light. And then I think the bigger jaw drop was finding out that the ghosts did it on their own free will.
Yeah.
It wasn't the Traveler. The ghosts just did it.
Yeah.
You know, kind of thinking about, like, you know, free will and how it relates to the ghosts. Mm-hmm. Jiggly Panda also asks, because we're gonna get out of Destiny questions here. I think that's it for our Destiny questions tonight. Asks, what's a moment in gaming that also made you say holy shit, made your jaw drop? That is such an open ended question.
Oh my God.
Just pick two for me, Corey.
All right. So when the Reapers show up in Mass Effect is pretty cool.
Yeah.
That's a pretty fucking awesome moment. And then for me, I guess another one that I can think of off the top of my head is the Dom and Maria moment in Gears 2. That's was a pretty holy shit moment. I don't want to spoil anything for anybody who hasn't played Gears 2. There's a pretty crazy story moment in the middle of that game. So, but that's the other one that I could think of off the top of my head.
I would agree with that.
Halo 3.
I would say
Warthog for race too, I guess.
Which one?
Halo 3's Warthog race off at the end.
Yeah, I've got a Halo one, but it's playing as the Arbiter.
Mm-hmm.
That was such an unexpected moment. Nobody saw that one coming.
Yeah.
Playing as the Arbiter, which was awesome, by the way. I don't want to spoil it for anybody. The sword pull in Tears of the Kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was pretty good.
That's a very special. That, and I mean, I would even say the final fight. The final part of the boss battle. Mm-hmm. Both totally unexpected.
Loved it.
I had one. Oh, there. I will say also, because I just rolled credits on it the other day, Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, the final fight of that game, did not see that coming, and that was fucking awesome. It was awesome. Remain so unspoiled if you like Final Fantasy. If you like Final Fantasy VII, stay as unspoiled as humanly possible. That was cool. I know I said two. I'm going to throw one out there that I can actually talk about because it's at the beginning of the game and it's been so long. Finding out in Final Fantasy 16 that Clive is Ifrit.
Mm-hmm.
That was a holy shit moment. Getting to control the icons was just incredible.
Yeah.
Absolutely phenomenal. I loved every single second of it. So, yeah. Sammy writes in and asks, have there been any games you've played recently to capture that Destiny feel, or has nothing matched it so far? I'm going to take this to mean, like, any multiplayer games that we feel has, like, captured that magic.
Yeah, I mean, not for me specifically, but I feel like Helldivers has really captured that recently.
I would say Helldivers. I personally don't feel it, but I know a lot of people in the Discord like it. Mm-hmm. I think Helldivers is an awesome game. I think the $40 price point really helps it more than just about anything.
Yeah.
It's very easy to jump into. It's very easy to get it to get, you know, sink a lot of time into. I just don't like, I don't care for the progression, but I do think that is probably the first game since Destiny that you're like, damn, you could see yourself spending a lot of time playing this game.
Yeah.
My, funny enough, my complaint about it is the complaint that everybody seems to have about Destiny that doesn't actually play the game, which is I would love more lore about this. And like, I get it. Like, not every game needs that, right?
Yeah.
But, I would say that's definitely the closest that we've seen, like, because The Division has just fallen off so hard.
You would think
Warframe is the only other thing I would say.
Yeah, you would think The Division has fallen off, but I feel like every other week Ubisoft is tweeting out, well, there's a Division update coming. All you agents, pull out your orange dickholes. And
who is still playing?
I have no idea, dude. I don't know.
I just want to know.
I don't know.
I just want to talk. I want to make sure that you're okay.
Blink twice if you need help. Yeah, I don't know, man. The Division.
Whatever. Scrolling down to try and figure out where we are. Spinny asks, what is your ranking of the Persona games 3, 4, and 5 from worst to best? Oh, holy shit.
Wait, what was the question? Sorry.
The ranking of the Persona games 3, 4, and 5 from worst to best.
Oh, man, I couldn't tell you.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I did buy Persona 3 Portable at limited run games at PAX.
This is... I'll talk to you afterwards. I really wish you would have told me that you were at Limited Run's booth. I would have asked you to get me a copy of Persona 4.
They didn't. It was sold out.
No!
Yeah. I went,
okay, I don't feel as bad.
I went during media hour and it was sold out.
I don't feel as bad then.
Yeah.
From what I understand, it basically sold out during the pre-sales too. Yeah. So.
Yeah.
I tried. So, oof. All right. I'm gonna rank these as the most like up to date versions of the games, mm-hmm. from worst to best. Jesus, now understand when I say the worst of these is like a top 25 game I've ever played. I need you to understand that's how good this series is. This is gonna be really, really sacrilegious. Persona 3 is third place for me. I absolutely adore the story. And the characters, I think it probably has the best I can't even say it has the best vanilla story, because I really love Persona 4's base story too. I think it has the most interesting party members by far. But Tartarus is a fucking slog. It's awful. 250 floors of bullshit. I don't think Strega is really as fleshed out as they should be. That's really frustrating to me. Also, it's frustrating that like we don't have the full package yet. The answer isn't out yet, and I know that's more supplemental content, but that's like another 20 hours of story that we're missing. That being said, I think the protagonist is absolutely fascinating, probably the second best protagonist of the three. I would even argue maybe the best, but I think that the relationships that Joker has during Persona 5 Royale in particular, uh-huh. in that final semester, maybe top this for me. This is the team that feels most like a team, I'll say, mm-hmm. because, you know, they all live in a dorm together. They're all friends. They all go to the same school. Like, it makes sense. It feels organic. Mm-hmm. And that's what I like a lot about 4 also. 4 feels fairly organic to an extent. Mm-hmm. Outside of like your last two party members, 5 doesn't really feel organic at all. And that's not a bad thing. Since I'm taking the whole package into consideration, I'd even stretch to say with the explorable world that I might move Reload to number 2. I got Persona 4 at number 2. Again, love the story, love the setting. Inaba's the best setting in the games. I don't care what anybody says. Inaba's the best setting. If you've never lived in a small town where there's nothing to do but go hang out at fucking Walmart, this is the game for you. It is like you get tired of like, oh my God, why are they Jew-ness this whole time? Like, that is what you do in a small town. You go hang out at food courts. You go hang out at fast food places. You hang out at, you know, at fucking Chili's. You go to Target. You go to things like that. Like, that is what you do in a smaller town. And like, my town wasn't super duper small. Like, I'm, you know, lived outside in the suburbs my whole life. But the town that I actually went to high school in was small. There were like 30,000 people in my town. And so like on Friday nights when there was football, everything shut down. Everybody went to the football, like all the local businesses shut down because everybody went to, you had to go to chain restaurants.
Yeah.
So you couldn't go to the pizza place over on Main Street because it was fucking closed. Like that's the kind of like town that we're talking about here. Like everybody knew everybody and, you know, it knew everybody's business and this and that. Like that's very much how Persona 4 is. It really captures that in a kind of creepy way. It introduces the concept of the father figure really to the games, which I think is something that 5 specifically really benefits from. Whereas like I really enjoy the party in 4. I think the party stories in 3 are better. I think the characters are better in 4, if that makes sense. And then you got 5, which is kind of the whole package to me. 5 has the best gameplay. It's got the linear dungeons. Everybody has the same dungeon. It has the best, I think the best combat system, pretty obviously. It has the best third semester content by far of any of the games. The Royale content is absolutely masterfully done. I think the base game is like, the base game really suffers after like the 80% mark probably, but Royale makes up for it in such a beautiful way that I really think like the relationships specifically with Joker and Akechi and Kasumi and Dr. Maruki and like how all of those like really come together for this content is really special. Like I can't imagine playing base Persona 5 without these stories also weaving in and out of it now. It adds so much context to what's going on with those social links and how those characters ultimately come together for the end. I was not as annoyed by certain characters in that game as everybody else. I also think there's just something to, there's something to your first Persona game. And I love that I worked my way backwards through these. 5 is like kind of my, it's kind of the gold standard. It kind of just like excels at everything. Like it has the best, in my opinion, it has the best side stories in any of the games. 3 also did really good at this, by the way. The non-party members had really good stories in 3.
Did you play Portable before you played Reload?
I tried to. I couldn't get into it. I really, really struggled with Portable.
Yeah, but you went backwards, right? Like, you did 5-4-3, right? You said.
I did 5-4-3, and that's why I struggled with it, I think. When I played Reload, I was hooked.
Yeah, I think I'm going to start with 3, probably. It's on my list after Final Fantasy VII.
I know you just bought Portable. I would strongly suggest Reload at this point.
Yeah. Yeah.
In that order, 3, 4, 5 from worst to best. But again, understand that when I'm saying 3 is the worst, 3 is still like a top 25 game I've ever played.
Yeah.
4 and 5 are both in my top 10, though.
Yeah.
Like 5 is arguably like one of the 3 or 4 best games of all time, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So like that's the answer you're getting. I took a long time on that question. I'm really sorry for everybody who does not give a shit about my thoughts on Persona. Titan writes in, non-Destiny related, but still gaming. Have you seen the Marvel Rivals promo? It looks really good. And I know much you guys love Yuri as Spider-Man. Sarcasm. But really, it looks like a lot of fun. It literally is the definition of, hey, Overwatch, can I copy your homework?
Yeah, I was just like, this looks like Overwatch with Marvel skins.
I'm really leery about this game because I do think it looks fun. I want to be really clear. I think it looks fun. I'm leery about it because it's NetEase making it. And if you don't know NetEase, they're a Chinese telecommunications company. They are a competitor to Tencent, which we already don't like Tencent. But I'm leery because of their monetization models when it comes to games like this. They are the guys behind Diablo Immortal, in case you needed to know. That is one of the best examples I can probably give you in terms of monetization. And look at all the stories you got there.
Didn't they fund Bungie's mobile game too?
They did. In fact, they were funding Gummy Bears. They were funding Gummy Bears. Yep.
Yep.
And that is seemingly not happening anymore. So yeah, I think this looks fun. I'm very interested in it.
That price,
but I'm very cautious until I see what that monetization model is going to look like.
Yeah, I mean, if it's going to be like a $70 game, and then you're going to get battle passes and
it is a quote free to play game.
Is it okay?
It's quote free to play. Really, what it means for games like this and like Apex Legends stuff, it's free to start.
Yeah, I looked at it and I was like, nah, I don't really like. As somebody who played a lot of Overwatch for 2 years, like. I don't know, man. I hope people that play it like it. That's all I can say. I'm not.
Yeah, I am genuinely very interested in this.
Yeah. So I like the art direction in the trailer, at least. I'm more interested in Marvel 1943 is the one that I'm really interested in. So. Did you see the 1943 trailer? I'm sure you did.
Yes. So here's my I'm gonna talk about this real fast because we are gonna talk about this on the next Xbox Casuals on Monday.
Yeah.
1943 looks awesome. Super excited. It's Amy Hennig's game. Everybody made such a big deal of how realistic the cutscene looked. Maybe if you didn't make cutscenes that looked like that, we wouldn't have $300 million games. I'm just saying, I would rather a game look like half as good, which still would be pretty goddamn good, by the way, and it be a fraction of the price and everybody get to keep their jobs rather than stuff like this that costs more than a Pixar movie. Just saying that's my thought. That's my thought.
It looks really good though. You have to admit.
So it does look good. And that's my thing. Like I'm stoked for the cast. I'm stoked for this game. I'm very excited. I love 1940s Steve Rogers.
Yeah, it's awesome.
And the fact that he's teaming up with T'Challa's grandfather is so exciting to me.
Yeah.
I just cannot get over. I love that Jeff Keighley was the one tweeting out like a screen recording of it too.
Yeah.
That was absolutely hysterical to me.
Yeah.
Oh man, I am.
Oh, Jeff Keighley.
It's incredulous about it. So. Jeff Keighley. Oh, boy.
He's out there. He's doing the thing.
Yeah, he's doing the thing. He's absolutely doing the thing. I think that's going to do it for questions tonight. Yes, that is going to do it, I believe, for questions for tonight.
I think we.
We hit them all. We are going to do a special lore corner tonight because there were a bunch of questions being asked about why is Shax labeled as husband on the flavor text in the Hall of Champions. And that comes from a very obscure lore piece attached to the vow bow from Crimson Days. So that's our lore tonight. We're going to read the vow.
Ooh.
In the courtyard of the tower, Lord Shax stares out at the last city. He puts his foot up on the railing and sighs. Arcite 9940 knows Shax's moods because they are his own moods. He sidles up to Shax and follows his gaze to the horizon. What's on your mind, boss? He asks with the friendly rhythm of a local bartender. Shax is quiet for a long time, but Arcite is indifferent to the passage of time. When Shax speaks, it is with a deep, sobering gravity. Today, he says, I will marry them all. Hours after, Arcite has finished tying off the bouquets and gathering the doves from the mountains beyond the city, Shax addresses the courtyard. Guardians, he booms. These crimson days are a time to renew our bonds to one another. We gather together. We remember what we owe each other. We declare our love. He holds up a bow for the crowd to see. Bring your fiery passion to the crucible. Prove your devotion to your bond. He pauses. To those of you who win this bow, I offer my hand in marriage. Take it or leave it. Arcite releases the doves. Someone screams. Doves have not been seen in the last city for a long time. I think that is fucking great. I had forgotten all about this piece of lore because I did not ever think to go read the lore on the Vow until one of the senior narrative designers tweeted it out and said that's where it comes from. So we were all like, what? And here we are 5 years later, actually getting to talk about this piece of lore.
Yeah, man, this is
I think that's great. Yeah. I think that is fantastic.
Does this mean
this is this Into the Light really is a love letter to the people who have been here since the beginning?
Yeah. Yeah.
That means canonically we're married to Shax.
Neat.
Neat.
Does this mean Shax can be it can be nominated for Husbando of the Year, Josh?
Do what?
So does that mean Shax can be nominated for Husbando of the Year?
Probably.
I'll have to keep that in mind for later. In the year. Man, good times. Husband Shax.
Husband Shax. Oh boy.
There's a horn joke in there somewhere, but I'm too tired to make it.
I am too.
Why don't we get out of here, Josh?
Let's get out of here, Corey.
Let's get out of here. I want to thank everybody for watching and or listening to this episode of Tower Casuals. Thank you to the people who said hi at PAX. You Tower Casuals fans, you. Josh, thank you for your time tonight as well.
Always.
Where can we find you?
At Josh underscore Finn.
At Josh underscore Finn. Two ends.
It is two ends. It's playoff rush time, baby. I'm ready.
Playoff time.
I'm ready.
Yeah. I don't think the Cavs are ready. That's okay. You can find me at I am Corey HG on Twitter and Instagram. You can follow us at Tower Casuals. New episodes every Friday. Check out Xbox Casuals. Thank you so much for watching and or listening. And until next time, we love you. Goodbye.